What about Steven?
He's gone, Mark.
What I think is beautiful about what the series is doing when it comes to a compassionate portrayal of DID...
We need to go back for him.
...is instead of, well, here's the core personality, and they're the real one.
Right.
And the alters are just fake, made-up ones. We get to know Steven as a real person.
Yeah.
He is a real, actual whole person.
Yeah.
And that is what the series is driving home. Anytime this is portrayed, it's creepy or it's a gimmick.
Yeah.
And here it is portrayed with such compassion and realism. People with DID have suffered, and they deserve compassion, not fear and judgment. What I love most about Moon Knight is that it's a love story, but the romantic love story is like a side thing that's going on.
Yeah.
And she's a great character, but it's really a love story between members of a system.
Right.
Sorry.
There's always gonna be reality merged with cinematic visual
language.
There
has to be cinematic license a little bit.
It's the ultimate bromance.
It really is. Oscar Isaac falls in love with Oscar Isaac. It's what we all dream of.
Hello and welcome to Cinema Therapy. I'm Jonathan Decker, licensed therapist who loves movies.
I'm Alan Seawright, professional filmmaker who needs therapy. What are we doing today?
Today we are doing Psychology of a Hero.
Ooh, I love Psychology of a Hero. Who's our hero?
Moon Knight.
There's a lot of psychology to talk about with Moon Knight.
There's so much psychology. And
I'm so curious to see how right they got it.
So first of all, they got it super right.
Really?
Yes. This is the best portrayal of dissociative identity disorder that I've ever seen.
Exactly what you would expect from a superhero franchise. What?
Exactly what you would expect from Oscar Isaac, who can do
no wrong.
Even when he does wrong, it's oh so right.
It's so right.
So often, dissociative identity disorder, for those who have seen our Split episode or our Gollum episode, it's a trope to scare people, or
sure,
it's a gimmick for storytelling, but it's almost never something that's shown with compassion or any level of clinical accuracy.
Yeah.
So Moon Knight really nails it. And of course, this is something to take into consideration. There's always going to be reality merged with cinematic visual
language.
There
has to be cinematic license a little bit.
Right. There are some cheats so that you could tell the they could tell the story they want to tell.
Sure.
And there's some cheats or some cinematic stylizations that represent something reality, but it's not exactly how it would play out.
Right.
But the core of it is very, very true.
Okay.
So let's take a look.
Oh, God.
So Egyptian monsters.
Steven.
I could save us. But I can't have you fighting me this time. You need to give me control. You understand?
What control of what? What are you talking about?
That thing's about to break through the door.
Okay. Cinematically, just doing all of this in one with all these mirrors.
Yeah.
Look at me.
I want to find the director and the visual effects supervisor and give him a hug.
It's the only way.
Yeah.
That's so much work.
I'm gonna die.
You're not gonna die. Let me save us.
Oscar Isaac does both the wimpy, cowardly, normal person and badass hero so well.
So well.
He does the British accent so well, he does the American accent so well. And he's Latino. His native language is Spanish.
Yeah, he grew up speaking Spanish at home. I love the implied violence of this scene.
The creature's like...
And you don't see a whole lot. I mean, a little bit right here.
That is a cool costume.
The implied violence of that fight scene, like you can get the audience to feel so much without having to show anything just by having sound effects and then a sink come flying out of a room.
Yeah.
And then you come around into a door and the room is just smashed all to hell. It's like, oh.
Well, I love that you get that brief moment of the devil dog or whatever it is. But like
running out and then it grabs. It's like, no!
No, my boy! Father, help!
Oh, it's so much fun. I just love telling stories and making pictures. It's fun. So I'm guessing, speaking of movies, cinematic license to alters or aspects or whatever you want to call them in DID, talking to each other in a mirror, probably not a typical thing?
Not to my knowledge. And having a dialogue and a conversation, again, is not unheard of, but it's not especially common. For any systems who are watching, if I get anything wrong this episode, by all means, correct me in the comments.
Please.
But my understanding is you don't get a lot of rapid switching, where you go, switching is from one personality to another back and forth.
Sure.
In movies with DID, it's really interesting. It's
more fun.
To see an actor do two roles at the same time. Like, of course.
Yeah.
But in real life, generally, you get into a gear and you stay there for a while.
You're kind of there, and then maybe you change to this, and you're there for a couple of days.
Yeah. Or by you, I guess it's more accurate to say they.
They,
you
know? For sure.
They get into a gear and they stay there. And in movies and in TV shows, the personalities are often very, very different with different speech patterns, different mannerisms, in this case, different accents and dialects.
Completely different, yeah.
And that is also common, but even more common is for it to be a lot more subtle.
Okay.
So that most people observing the person wouldn't realize that there's another personality.
It would just be, this person is behaving very differently.
Yes.
But it's still the same person.
This video is sponsored by Fabulous, the number one self-care app to help you build better habits and achieve your goals. It's an app that helps you build routines and track your goals and habits, and Fabulous has different programs to help improve your daily habits, relationships, and mental health. It's all based on behavioral science, and it breaks down healthy habits into small tasks that you can achieve every day. So you're building science-backed daily routines that help make it easy to develop and stick to healthy habits. It's 100% personalized, so you can choose habit tracking for specific habits you're focused on right now, or dedicated programs that take you on a several-week guided journey with lessons and inspiring messages. With Fabulous Premium, you can build and improve an unlimited number of habits in your routines and access all of the programs and exercises. Fabulous also has great features like a self-care menu and a self-care pie chart that help you remember to do the things that are gonna keep your mind and your body super healthy. There are meditation exercises and breathing exercises to help you when you're feeling overwhelmed or to help keep you from getting overwhelmed in the first place. Like, what if you have to, say, deliver 65 episodes of a YouTube show every year, but you're also shooting a short film and you decided to do all the visual effects for it yourself instead of hiring someone else to do it? That would be really hard to do. Anyway, start building your ideal daily routine. The first 500 people who click on the link will get 25% off of a Fabulous subscription. It's both fabulous because of what it is and fabulous because it's the app. It's a double entendre.
This is all your fault!
Calm down, Mark. Mark, I didn't shoot you. Your mind is violently vacillating between sense and nonsense. Picture this, all right? Your brain is a pendulum swinging between a very difficult reality that you are my patient here at Putnam Medical Facility in Chicago, Illinois, and a reassuring fantasy that you've created on your own, that you're some kind of...
No medical facility in Chicago looks like that.
Everything and everything possible.
That's your first clue, Mark.
Then you're not really a doctor. Is that why you keep starting imaginary fights in our hospital?
You're not a doctor.
I feel real.
Well, Ethan Hawke is good as Harrow the villain. He's amazing as Harrow the psychiatrist.
So much fun. Well, all right. It's not about me, okay? Let's start with you. Let's try it your way. Retrace your steps. Tell me, how did you come to be here today?
How did you get here?
I took the bus. You want to know what you told me? How you got here? You told me that you were in a place that was oddly reminiscent of this office, except that it was in Egypt, right? And that you were with a rhinoceros and...
Hippopotamus.
You're right. You're right. It was a hippopotamus. Now, what do you think? Do you think that is sense? Or nonsense?
Oh, man.
Nonsense?
I find this really encouraging. Honestly, I do. The struggling mind will often build places to seek shelter for different aspects of the self from our most traumatic memories. It's called just an organizing principle, okay? Some people, they see a castle, right? Somebody else will see a maze. Or a library.
Where is it? A psych ward?
Yep, or...
I'll have comments on this, but I don't want to interrupt it. It's so...
There's so much good stuff here.
What I find extremely interesting is this new, the new animal character.
Hippopotamus?
I find that really interesting.
Here's the thing that I find deeply unsettling. Therapists are so often inaccurately and poorly portrayed. Mm-hmm. And here I'm watching, he's a damn good psychologist.
Yeah.
Or psychiatrist if he prescribes meds, but...
Right.
But he's, everything he's saying, like from his strategy to the insights that he's making to the way that he's asking the questions and talking about the pendulum swing and asking Mark, is this sense or nonsense? And talking about organizing principles and pointing out the comforting fantasy and all the things that he's pulling from this office to create that fantasy.
Sure.
All of his observations are spot on. All of his questions are spot on. And the patience and kindness and empathy needed to guide someone
through
this.
Well, and the realness. He doesn't feel like he's putting on a suit of patience and kindness, right? He feels like he's a nice, kind guy.
He's the villain playing a part.
Right.
But usually when you have villains pretending to be decent, they overplay their hand as actors. Mm-hmm. It's directed that way so that you know they're still...
Oh, don't worry. It's still a bad guy.
Yeah. And
you're not getting that hand tip here anywhere. Which
if you
is
see
great.
This, yeah. If you see the scene in isolation, you're like, this is the best screen therapist since Robin Williams of Good Will Hunting.
Right.
He's just
super, super good. And what's so great about it, and what I loved that they super committed to that from a storytelling standpoint, is we're 5 episodes in, and we've been, you know, we've spent at this point 3 hours with this character. And it's like, wait a minute, was this all in his head?
Yeah.
Is it? Wait, what is real? To get that far into a show and just yank the rug out from under everybody is just like, oh, wow, okay.
It reminds me of that Buffy episode where they do a similar thing and they leave the door open for it's up to your interpretation. Is the entire series in Buffy's head while she's in the psych ward?
Is the whole thing made up?
Or is she actually a vampire slayer? And that's not a spoiler because the episode literally is like, it's whatever you think it is.
Uh-huh.
Like, and it's so, yeah, it's very much like this.
Yeah, it's pretty daring.
Can't you believe the secret trampoline we found?
No, it's so great.
What this nails clinically is the concept of dissociation. When he talks about organizing principles, this safe place that you can retreat to, for some people it's a mansion, or, you know, it could be a library or a museum.
Or
a psych ward. That dissociation isn't always, I'm in a place that's not real, but it can be.
Mm-hmm.
And what it always is a safe space in the mind. Even if I'm still in the present and in the physical location that I am actually in, I can create a safe space in my mind so that this all feels manageable.
I don't... This is my room. I remember some things, but I don't remember this.
It's not Mom, it's not my Mom. It's not my Mom.
Mark, open this door. Open this door right now.
It's not my Mom.
Open this door.
Bloody hell. Look at the state of this place.
Man, this kid's good too.
4 months, she's it.
Mark, open the door right now!
I love the plot twist. That we think that...
Danger is near. Stephen Grant has no fear.
I cried so hard when...
You made me up.
When he read that, because danger is near and he wants to feel no fear.
You're gonna learn to listen. Why do you have to make him do this?
I want to see what she did. I want to see what she did.
Disgusting.
You're not meant to see that. You're not meant to see that. That's the whole point of you. Oh! The point of me?
The point of me what, to be a stress ball? All this time I thought I was the original. But I'm just something that you made up.
You've got to live a happy, simple, normal life. You understand?
But it was all a lie, wasn't it?
So what? What does it matter? What, you want to remember the truth? That you had a mother that beat you? That hated you? That made your life a living hell?
You're lying, you're just trying to upset me. But you've gotten to live thinking that she loved you, that she was kind, that she's still alive. She's alive. I speak to her every day. What are you talking about?
Dad called me after all these years about her Shiva, and I couldn't do it.
This is all wrong. This is all wrong.
Stephen, I'm sorry.
Oh, no, 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 no. No, 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 thank you.
No.
Let me out.
Can we talk about performance for a second? Because I know we fanboy over Oscar Isaac and stuff.
Rightly so.
Holy crap.
That was some good performance, Mr. Isaac. I would like to subscribe to your newsletter.
We'd like to have you on the show.
Maybe
take you out for a nice lobster thermidor. You know, see what happens.
What could possibly happen?
Nothing, but...
Oh, my goodness. But please come on the show, seriously.
What I and so many people love about this show, you look at Split, you look at all, so many times, like anytime this is portrayed, it's creepy or it's a gimmick.
Yeah.
And here it is portrayed with such compassion and realism. You know, I said in our Gollum episode, even though I got some things wrong in that episode, something that I got right is people with DID have suffered and they deserve compassion, not fear and judgment.
Yeah.
The idea, you're not supposed to see this, that's the whole point of view.
That's the whole point of view. It's such a smart storytelling technique to start with, because he's the main character.
Yeah.
Right? Steven's the main character. He's the main character of episode one. He's the focus character of many of the scenes.
Yeah.
Generally speaking, the first character, like the character that you follow into a scene or the first one that you see in a scene, your brain is just programmed to think like, this is the main character of this scene. We often, almost all the time, start on Steven when there's Steven and Mark.
Yeah.
And so you're programmed to think that just by cinematic language.
Nope.
It's all a magic trick.
And when Steven says, I thought all this time that I was the original, but I was just something that you created. What I think is beautiful about what the series is doing when it comes to a compassionate portrayal of DID is instead of, well, here's the core personality and they're the real one.
Right.
And the alters are just fake made up ones. We get to know Steven as a real person.
Yeah.
He is not an alter. He is not something made up, even though in this moment he thinks that's how he interprets it.
He finds that out and starts questioning his own...
But he is a real, actual whole person.
Yeah.
And that is what the series is driving home. This is where we talked about Split, that Split fell apart, is that a lot of the personalities didn't really serve a purpose.
They were just cool vehicles for James McAvoy to be a badass.
Right.
And he was.
But here, Steven serves a very clear purpose, which is that young Mark has lost his brother. Young Mark has a mother who hates him and abuses him. And psycho-emotionally, that body, that brain, can only take so much of that.
Right.
And so Steven emerges. See, I like the phrase emerge rather than created. Steven emerges to protect Mark.
Yeah.
So Mark doesn't have to take all that. Mark can disappear, and the brain and the body can experience a happy childhood.
Yes.
And that when Mark comes back, he's had a reprieve. You know, like that is the reason that Steven exists. There's a third one, Jake Lockley,
right,
who serves an even more protective function because Mark has to operate with a conscience.
Uh-huh.
And Jake Lockley doesn't.
Does not. Support us on Patreon. Go to patreon.com/cinematherapy and check out the cool bonus content for all of our patrons. It could be you. You could be a patron.
So then we get what he's talking about, that he can't go to his mother's Shiva, which is a Jewish... It's not a funeral. It's an extended mourning period.
Right.
So there's a lot that goes into it, but he can't go to his mother Shiva, and this happens. His father sees him, and he can't bring himself to go in. So right now, this is Mark. I'm not laughing because it's funny. I'm just laughing because Oscar Isaac is a freaking master actor.
He's so good. He's playing the emotion, and he's playing drunk, and it's funny, but not... It's mostly sad.
And now he's playing... Isn't he Mark right now watching himself, or is he Steven watching Mark?
Steven watching.
Yeah. I love the compassion Steven has for him. And that level of grief, that acting is very, that's how it feels. So again, what's going to happen is the brain and the body, it's too much. And so to spare Mark, Steven is going to emerge.
What?
What?
Where am I? Bloody hell, what?
Bloody hell.
Oh, bollocks. Not again. Hey, Mum. Hey, you all right? Yeah,
So now Steven sees what's really happening. He's watching himself.
Yeah.
I am totally lost.
But here, the brain and the body get to believe Mom's still alive, and we had love.
No, I know, I did it again. But I don't know, I'm looking down a street.
And Oscar, now we have Steven watching Steven. Mark watching Steven watching Steven.
Mm-hmm.
And Oscar Isaac's doing all of it.
The moment our lives started bleeding into each other.
Milwaukee.
At different times, on different days, possibly.
I read this. No, they filmed it all the same day with, you know.
With a double, and then you turn it around. And
yeah.
All
the things I'd done. Mark, all those horrible things that she said to you, she was wrong. It wasn't your fault. I shouldn't have brought him in that cave. I shouldn't have brought him in the cave. Hey. Hey. You were just a child. It wasn't your fault.
Most powerful special effect in all of cinema.
So I read this. Oscar Isaac was talking about on the day how much mental work he had to do to make sure, okay, who am I? And and not just, I'm not just playing these two different characters, but I'm observing myself.
Right.
You know, in these different spaces, and the most important love that you can get is self-love. And for a system, the self is a collective. It's like y'all.
Sure. Yeah.
Right? But something that I thought was so beautiful about Moon Knight, you know, whatever its flaws, because to me it had flaws as a superhero story, but as an exploration of DID, it's practically as flawless as you can get on film.
I can go along with that.
Because again, like, you have to use cinematic language. Like, I don't know that people, like, they do this when they're switching, but you have to do something so the audience sees it happening and you know.
Unless you're James McAvoy.
Yeah. Well, no, but even then, he does this, like, the stuff that he does.
He does that sometimes when he moves from Barry to Dennis in that one scene, though.
Yeah.
It's just, his face and his posture, and it's just like, oh.
But what I love most about Moon Knight is that it's a love story. Mm-hmm. But the romantic love story is like a side thing that's going on.
Yeah.
And she's a great character.
Sure,
she's
a
badass Egyptian superhero. But it's really a love story between members of a system.
Right.
That really the whole time, Steven was there to protect Mark. And in turn, Mark protected Steven. And it's absolutely beautiful. And when they're on the boat and Towerit, she's saying,
"You don't need him anymore, Mark.
You made it to paradise."
Yeah.
And he's like, "I can't leave him.
Can't go in without him."
Yeah, and we get this, which is just so good.
Steven.
Mark, who was annoyed by Steven at the beginning.
Off, man. I don't know if you can hear me. From the moment you arrived. Way back then. We were so young. You saved me. I survived because I knew I wasn't alone. You were always there, alive, full of hope. And I tried to protect that, and I failed. I couldn't protect you. But you didn't abandon me. You didn't abandon me. And all of that, all that field back there was looking at. It's a looking pretty good. There's no way in hell I'm gonna abandon you. You are the only real superpower I ever had.
So awesome. And so many systems saw Moon Knight and said, I feel seen. This is what it's like. We love each other. We look out for each other. Because of each other, we're not alone. It's not a crazy thing in my head that needs to be cured. It is another state of being.
Yeah. Oh, God. Steven.
In some ways, it really is a superpower.
Yeah. Not in the way that M. Night Shyamalan was.
Not that way.
What was wrong with you? Well, I did a whole little speech there. I was not little. You asshole.
It's the ultimate bromance.
It really is. Oscar Isaac falls in love with Oscar Isaac. It's what we all dream of.
It's double servings. It's fantastic.
What more could you want? More Oscar Isaac. Don't worry, there's going to be a season two with more Oscar Isaac.
So this love story, I just absolutely adore. And in some cases, it really depends on system by system. Mm-hmm. You know, some systems, they see themselves as, we're here to serve an original person.
Sure.
And once we're no longer needed, we'll fade into the night, and that's fine. Like, and that's integration. And for a long time, people in my field saw that as the goal.
That's always the goal, right?
That's always the goal, is to get them back to normal, where it's just one. But the more we study and the more we listen to the experiences of people who live with this, for a lot of them, integration isn't the goal.
Right.
The goal is living in harmony. The goal is being aware of one another so we don't wake up with lost time and saying, what happened?
Yeah, that's probably not ideal.
Well, and there is a type of integration that happens universally, which is we influence and learn from one another.
Sure.
And you see that at the end when Steven is now just as capable of kicking ass as Mark.
And has a better suit. I'll say it.
No.
It's better.
No, it's very dapper. It's very cool.
Looking good.
But the whole scene where they're rapid switching back and forth, that's a scene, by the way, that as a therapist, instead of saying rapid switching doesn't really happen a whole lot like that, I'm like, oh, this is cool.
Yeah, you know what else doesn't happen? Egyptian gods granting you superpowers that are reliant on a suit that magically appears out of the ground?
Right. At that point, you just roll with it. And so at that point, I wasn't nitpicking. I'm like, oh, bad. They're working together.
Hey, fighty, punchy. Neat.
I just think they're neat.
But the DID stuff in Moon Knight is fantastic. And honestly, as a mental health professional and speaking for, you know, systems that I know and systems that follow us and love us, thank you for representing and doing it well and doing your research.
Yes.
We talk about in our split episode, how it's important to separate, you know, fantasy from reality, and if you're watching a film, make sure you're not thinking this is how it is. But there is power when people do the research and they approach it with sensitivity, that audiences can learn some really genuine, true stuff about things. So, Marvel, thank you. Honestly, that's awesome.
And Oscar Isaac, thank you for just...
all of it.
All of it.
All of it. So until next time, what do you think that is? Sense? Or nonsense?
We do come as like a package deal now, so you're gonna have to deal with me too.
And watch movies. And Disney Plus series.